This is exactly what I've been on about.
What happened?
I get called out to see a man who scalded himself. When I get there, to the factory, what he's done is spilled a cauldron of boiling water into his industrial Wellington boot. Basically, he's cooked his feet. I don't have enough dressing, I don't have strong enough painkillers.
Oh, boy.
And when the ambulance arrives, I don't have anything either.
Well, listen, all I can say is, if you want to have another go at Middleditch when we see him later, I will back you up 100%, right?
Thank you. That means a lot.
With a bit of luck, we'll have the results back by the end of the day.
I'm sorry to put you to so much trouble. You know what my Aunt Mary's like.
I do, yes.
I was only a bit tired. My own doctor's booked me in to see a perfectly good specialist to do some tests in a couple of weeks. But oh no, I have to see her doctor as well.
Well, you can't be too careful. You are running a slight temperature. And the fact that your lymph glands are up shows you've got some sort of infection. Don't worry. We'll know more when we get the results of this.
For those of you who haven't met him before, this is Mr. Harper, who has been commissioned by the District Health Authority to conduct a time and motion study on the way that we work here. Mr. Harper will be with us until the end of the week, and I have assured the authorities that we will give him our fullest cooperation at all times.
Yes. Quite.
Dr. Weatherall, would you be so kind as to start Mr. Harper off in casualty?
Yes, of course. You'd like to follow me.
Mr. Middleditch, sorry, I don't mean to go on, but there was yet another incident today where I found myself with inadequate supplies to treat a patient properly on site. Now, we really must have adequate supplies on standby, and I'm afraid all the time.
Dr. Ormerod, I am as keen as you are to have an immediate care kit. It's simply that the kitty is empty. I really am sorry.
Well, on the other hand, I suppose we've got a way to set up a fund and pay for the thing ourselves.
Right. Now, casualty, Mr. Harper, is the gateway to the hospital. It is the first contact that our nursing staff have with sick and injured people, some of whom need very urgent medical attention. So I suggest that you find yourself a little corner, you stand still, and you try not to get in anybody's way. OK. Jockey?
Yeah, I know. Johnny Carroll.
That's the one. Back in the moor.
Well, Mr. Greengrass, keep getting better at this rate and you'll be able to go home by the end of the week.
That's good, isn't it?
Are you potty or something? I'm not even sure I've got home to go to. And even if I have, I'm so skint I couldn't afford to buy out, even if it were free. I'll stop here, thank you. Courtesy of the good old NHS.
Can't stop here if you're not ill.
Can't I? You watch me. Nurse. I've been told I've got to increase my liquid intake. Any chance of a cup of tea, three sugars, not too much milk?
I'll see what I can do, Mr. Greengrass.
You want to get yourself booked in here for a fortnight?
So, it's just there. Can you see? It's just a simple fracture, but it does need to be plastered up all the same.
You can't do that.
Yes, I can. I'm quite good at it.
No, I mean, I'm a jockey. I'm meant to be riding on Friday.
Well, put it this way, Mr. Carroll. Either you miss this race because your leg's in a plaster, or you miss a lot because it isn't. And we need to keep you in overnight to check for a concussion.
Right. Right. Let's start by getting your trousers off, shall we?
Johnny Carroll, the jockey.
Oh, him won't, Claude. He's broken his ankle.
We're riding this thing in the 1:30 at York on Friday, then.
No, there's more chance of knitting fog.
What? Morning, Johnny. What do you fancy in the 1:30? You're down for a ride. You must have some idea.
It's between the two favourites. Depends on what the going's like.
How do you mean?
Oh, look. Keep an eye on the weather between now and Friday, all right? If you have any more rain, and it's soft to heavy, yellow peril's a certainty. If it clears up and it's good to firm, white lightning's a good thing.
Good to know that, Claude. You could do with the wind, get you back to Barbados.
Hey, more chats than things might. Mind you, I'll tell you something, Johnny. You're better off in here, because that thing you were down to ride's got no chance.
You never know with blue skies.
See, the form, it's not been in the frame for the last six runs. The last twice, I'm not surprised, it's 33-1. You seen it?
you're probably right.
I will fly a yellow paper sun in your sky when the wind is high. When the wind is high, I will float a silver, silver moon near your window. If your night is dark, if your night is dark.
There are several things it could be, Fran. But the first results of your blood test do suggest there's more to it than just an infection.
Well, what else could it be?
I know it's worrying for you, for all of you. But I wouldn't like to make a proper diagnosis without running some more tests.
More tests?
Just some more blood. And it might be worth doing a biopsy. Take some tissue. Bone marrow. You'd need to come into the hospital tomorrow.
We're going shopping in Scarborough tomorrow. Steve can stay over with us. And then we'll drive you in first thing in the morning, get it over and done with. We can always go shopping another day.
You're joking. You've got to run him. There'll never be a chance like this again. I have not hooked him up on here for naught. Get Greenaway to ride him. He's a good job, man. Tell him if he wins, he'll copper a monkey. He'll win all right. For 500 quid, he'd win riding his grandmother. He's 33-1 in the life, right? I want a grand on.
Then there's another hernia. There you're all more with no complications. And then there's the gallstones.
Fat, fair, flatulent and forty.
Pretty much. But if you could put the bone marrow biopsy on top of the list, the sooner we know the results, the better, really.
Big increase in the white corpuscle count?
Vast, yes.
Oh.
Now, it's not a big up. You'll be back on the ward before you know it, and you can have a nice cup of tea when you wake up.
Thanks. Honestly, would have thought you'd grown out of all that by now, Uncle Ken.
Well, you'd have thought wrong, wouldn't you? So there. No, it's to raise money for the immediate care fund. Don't suppose you'd be interested in a couple of tickets, would you, sister?
I suppose it's worth half a crown to not have you nagging me.
How much time do you allot to each patient concerning your surgery?
It depends what's wrong with them, really.
All right, put it this way. How many do you see during surgery hours?
It depends how many there are.
Lights are up. Anyone will do. Somebody's got themselves pinned under a train or something at Elsinby Station. All right, go on. I'll cover for you.
You are a hero. And this time I'm going to prepare properly.
Hello, Johnny. Hope you ride a few winners when it gets better.
Johnny Carroll, bent.
There's a nine bob note. I knew that one, blue skies form. He's not been trying on it, he's been hooking it up.
Why?
Why? The oldest dodge in the book, innit? Him and the trainer in it together. You get a good hoss, right? Keep strangling it, get some weight off its back. Wait until the punters are sick and tired of backing it, and then when it's a good price, in you go and cop for a nice touch.
That's dishonest.
Of course it is, but very profitable. The funny thing is, the one time it's a racing certainty, he can't ride it, can he? That's why they've had to bring a new jockey in on Friday. I heard them arranging it on the phone. They're having thousands on it, and it's 33-1 in the life. We're going to cop a few quid ourselves here, Bernie, trust me.
Where is he? Into the station, straight down the platform, and you'll see what's happened. You've got to get a move on. He's trapped right under the flatbed.
Can you help me with this, please?
Oh, I can't come with you. I've got to wait here, so the ambulance man where to go. Then when the crane comes...
All right, all right. I'll manage this myself.
So, all we've got to do is scrape together every penny we can find, bung it all on Blue Skies and Roberta's your auntie.
Claude, I'm not sure about all this.
Look, you're the one that said I shouldn't be stopping in here. I'm just trying to get a few quid to take home.
Yeah, I suppose.
Thank you. Right, what you do is you tell everybody I'm running a book on the 130 at York and I'm giving better odds than anybody else. Just make sure you get all the money up front. And the other thing is, don't take any bets on Blue Skies, all right? Your sister Bridget, she could be your first customer.
What are you up to now, Mr. Greengrass?
We've just decided to go into the bookmaking business. Go on, ask her.
I don't suppose you nuns are interested in gambling, are you?
We're lifting the wagon back on track, and lifting gear failed. Jerry ran forward to try and stop it from falling that far. Oh,
hello, Jerry. I'm Dr. Ormerod. Let's take a look at you, shall we? All right. Now tell me. Okay, I'm going to need some oxygen. It's in the box. We'll get it for me, please. Now, I'm going to try and make this a bit less painful for you, okay, Jerry? I'll keep a way of getting this off. I know it's difficult, but I want you to try and relax. All right? I'm going to give you some morphine, which is going to kick in very, very fast. Okay? Don't worry. We'll soon have you out of here.
Just really, really tired.
Well, I'm not surprised. It'll be the sea air.
Steve. I may be quite ill, you know.
Well, then you're in the best place, darling. I mean, these doctors, they know what they're doing.
How many will you have?
I'll have four.
Four tickets, that's two. There you go.
All in a good cause.
Lord knows what I'll do with him if I win. No, I'm just trying to give the young people a moment alone.
Just a bit sore.
I'm not surprised with them taking a great lump out of you. I just hope they put an appointment on it.
Yeah.
I do love you, you know. I can't bear seeing you not well.
I'm giving you as much morphine as I dare. How long's it going to take you to get this thing off him?
Well, his gear's trapped under the wagon. Nearest crane's up on branch line at Aidensfield. Take maybe half hour to get here.
Half an hour?
It's on its way.
No. We don't have half an hour to waste. Well, I don't like the look of that load. Is it safe?
We nearly slid off when wagon collapsed, but we can't secure it. Not without getting up wagon, anyway.
OK, let's think. Spades, shovels, picks, anything. Yeah. That ground looks soft. We might be able to dig him out from underneath. OK?
Right. Yeah, come on, lads, come on.
And hurry! Every moment's precious.
At least you've got him comfortable. And there's nothing more that can happen to him, is there? The damage has been done.
There's no blood circulating through his legs.
What?
It's just sitting there, soaking up the poisons from his damaged tissues. And when we release the pressure, the poison's going to flood through the rest of his body, also his kidneys. So, no, the damage hasn't been done. In fact, it's probably only just started.
Greengrass, could you 8-1 on yellow peril?
Yeah. Sounded good to me. Especially as the bookies really offered 6-1. Uncle Ken said he got the tip straight from Johnny Carroll as well.
Yeah, but did he tell you it's only a good tip if it rains a lot between now and Friday?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but how do you know it'll rain?
It's Yorkshire.
He's up to something. I don't know what it is, but he's up to something.
You're doing really well, Jerry. Now, the ambulance is waiting, so you'll soon be nice and comfy. Jerry? Can you still hear me, Jerry? Mm. 11:29. Right on time. Better get crossing closed.
Then for God's sake, stop it, man. Got to get him out.
You can't stop the 11:29. It's an express.
I don't care if it's a Flying Scotsman. If that train comes through here, this lot's going to come crashing down.
So I have to put this in my report. I'll need your name.
How are we doing?
We're nearly clear here.
OK, this is what's going to happen. We're going to lift his shoulders. I want you to slide that stretcher underneath and we're going to gently ease him out. All right? I'll splint him in the ambulance. OK, come on. Gently. Nearly there.
What do you think?
I reckon so, yeah.
Okay, we've got to get this right,
then. It's clear here.
All right. Let's do it! Go! Ah! It's clear!
Thank you, Lizzie.
I saw that young lady manning casualty yesterday. Reception desk this morning, and now she makes tea.
Among other duties as my secretary, yes.
So, in which of these capacities is she particularly qualified?
I beg your pardon?
Qualifications, Mr. Middleditch. What qualifications does she possess?
A good heart, a willing disposition, and entirely adequate shorthand.
In other words, none. I only mention it as I see no professional certificates bearing your name either.
Mr. Harper, my grandfather founded this hospital, and in his day, a gentleman did not require a certificate before doing good work amongst the community. And I was brought up to respect that tradition.
Yes, I'm sure. However, in this day and age, the NHS has been established to provide a more reliable form of public welfare. I suppose it's the diametrically opposed doctrines of paternalism and state socialism. Herbert Hoover.
Balderdash. T.J. Middleditch.
Jerry Hanrahan, 29, crushed up in a goods wagon. Fractures to both legs, possibly comminuted.
Right, let's get him up. 2, 3, lift. Don't go anywhere, Ken. X-ray in 2 minutes. Start putting his trousers off. How long was he crushed for?
Well, he was under the wagon for at least 2 hours.
Really?
And another 20 minutes or so bringing him back here.
What's this? Who's been under a goods wagon?
A workman, Mr. Rose. We've just brought him in. He's been prepared for X-ray now.
Uh-huh. Excuse me. Acute thrush syndrome?
Very possibly.
Nasty. Ever come across it before?
No, sir, I haven't.
Shoots the kidneys all to hell and back. When I've finished here for today, I should be at the golf club this afternoon. You can get me there if you want any help with anything.
Thank you, sir. We will.
And tidy yourself up, man. It's a hospital.
And that was me wondering what all these sick people were doing here.
Well, are you free for some lunch in half an hour or so?
Possibly. Got to do something first, though.
Yeah, what?
Just something else I've never had to deal with before.
I did eat the jelly.
Well, you never get your hair to curl, that's all I can say.
Serious, huh?
What do you mean?
Oh, you wouldn't pull the curtains round if you're going to tell me I've got measles, would you?
No, probably not.
Do you want to sit down?
Thank you. Fran, the tests we've done show... they show you don't have an infection as such.
No.
We thought at first it might have been anemia, but...
What did the test show?
Well, they show you have a great many more white corpuscles in your blood than you should do.
Why? It's not leukemia, is it?
Yes, it is. I'm so very sorry.
Wish I hadn't asked now.
The blood tests, the changes in your bone marrow, they tell us you have acute myeloblastic leukemia. Now, what this means is...
Sano will die from this. When?
We can treat the symptoms with drugs, of course, and the blood transfusions...
Dr. Cheriton, we've done really well so far. Let's just... How long have I got?
I don't know, Fran. You may want to go home, and it's your decision, of course. But I think we will all advise against it.
You mean I don't get out of here alive, then? Oh, God!
I couldn't think what else to do. You must think I'm a right drip.
Actually, I think you're a smasher. If I'd have been in her position, I'd wanted you to give me a hug as well.
You'd have to be that desperate, huh?
Not necessarily.
Better be good, Ormerod. I was 4 strokes up on the High Sheriff.
Well, you did offer, Mr. Rhodes. As things stand here with Mr. Hanrahan, we're in a bit of a bunker.
Good heavens, it looks as though you're right. Some of the troops, have them scrub up. If we can't fix this with pins, I shall have to amputate.
I promised you, Mother. I promised I'd look after you.
And you have. You didn't fail me. This isn't anybody's fault.
She's right, Miss Graham. There's nothing you or anyone else could have done to prevent this.
Well, surely they should have spotted it sooner.
This form of leukemia is very easily mistaken for other things in the early stages.
Oh, stop being so reasonable all the time.
Believe me, I do understand how you feel.
How? Did your niece die of leukemia when you'd brought her up from being a wee small thing?
Aunt Mary, please.
It's all right. You'd obviously prefer to be alone with your niece. If I might ask you to lower your voice so as not to disturb the other patients.
Nope. It looks as though we're pinching the tibial artery. About here. Left hand down a bit, Dr. Wetherall. And a bit of a stretch. Right. Let's have a look at that. It's extraordinary, really, when you come to think of it. 50 years ago, this bloke wouldn't have stood a chance. Kept his life, he'd have lost his leg. Now, I can take a photograph of what's going on as it's going on and put it right. Never been able to explore an artery like this in my grandfather's day.
Well, I think Dr. Ormerod's prompt action on sight might have had something to do with this man's survival.
Yes, of course, my dear.
You'll have your blood transfusion first thing in the morning. You won't believe how much better you'll feel.
That's good. Sister, do you think I could have a word with Matron in private? I just wanted to apologise for my aunt's behaviour earlier on. She's so upset about all this, it just sometimes takes the form of anger, that's all.
It's often the way.
I'd understand if you'd rather she didn't come back.
I'm not usually in the habit of banning visitors, Miss Wheeler.
Good. Well done, everybody. Plaster him up. Keep an eye on his waterworks.
Staff, I think I can just about manage to stay in this position for another 30 seconds.
Oh, yes, Doctor.
Are you sure?
Yes. I think a 10 shilling bet would do me rather nicely, thank you very much, Mr. Greenglass. Now, I've heard that you're hoping for better weather.
I think I might have picked the wrong one, Doctor.
So, you must be looking forward to getting home soon, aren't you?
Yes. The only snag is, of course, I keep you up in these, these relapses.
Yes, well, just as long as yellow peril doesn't bring on another one. How's he doing?
His blood pressure's still a bit low, but his pulse is steady. He still hasn't passed water, though.
Oh, really? Well, it could still be the shock, I suppose. Keep a close eye on him, will you, sister?
Of course.
Tell me something, Matron. On our rounds each morning, it seems to me that we spend a great deal of time either waiting for a patient to pass water or discussing why they haven't. It occurs to me that by giving these patients a diuretic drug...
A diuretic, Mr. Harper?
When I was commissioned to do this study, I thought it wise to acquaint myself with the basics. And it says here about diuretics.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Harper. I don't seem to have my spectacles.
It's wonderful to see you looking so much better.
Feels good from this side, too.
You've even got some colour back in your cheeks.
Yeah.
They might be wrong, you know.
Steve, I'm dying. I feel better, I look better, because I've been given good, healthy blood. It's just doing its job. I'm being looked after wonderfully here. I know this must be awful for you and Aunt Mary, but for me, knowing at last, not tearing myself apart with worry. It's like a huge weight has been lifted from my shoulders.
I don't know what to do.
There is nothing to do, love.
Will you marry me?
Don't be silly, darling.
We have water for Mr. Hanrahan.
Let joy be unconfined.
I'll get the tests done right away.
Mr. Fairbank, are you all right?
Well, I know she doesn't think I'm up to much, but it's getting to the point where I don't do anything in the house or with the kids in case I get it wrong.
Thought you should know, Dr. Ormerod. You're a cute crush man. He just passed water. No blood, no protein. I think we're on the winning side.
Well, you really got that one wrong, didn't you? Saved his life and everything. Well done.
You and I should have a little chat.
All right.
I want to know what you think you're achieving.
I beg your pardon?
You sent your young man off with a flea in his ear, and you'd have done the same for your aunt if I'd let you. Why? Do you dislike them that much?
Dislike them? I'm dying. Do you think I want them to watch that?
So, you'd rather they remembered you as someone who rejected their love?
I don't want to hurt them. I'm just trying to save them pain.
Well, you won't. You think they care so little about you that they won't grieve when you go, that they'll just, I don't know, say cheerio, walk out of here and never think of you again?
I don't know.
Well, I do. In all my years of nursing, I've never seen it happen yet. I know you're trying very hard to be brave, but you must allow others a chance to be brave as well. Steve's very upset that you turned down his proposal of marriage.
It's romantic nonsense.
Well, most proposals are, but that never stopped anyone, did it?
What's the point? I mean, we don't exactly have a future together, do we?
No. But Steve has a future on his own, Fran. Do you want him to spend it thinking about how the woman he loved turned him away?
or having a photograph of you as his bride, and remembering how happy you made each other.
Get up then.
What?
All right, Claude. What's this I hear about you running a book on Friday's race?
Well, you heard what Carol said about it was between the two short price favourites. Anyway, my money's going to be on it drying up, that's all.
There's something you're not telling me.
Don't talk, Dad. Mind you, I couldn't have to do with a bit of that West Indian sunshine without the flies.
Don't let the sun catch you crying.
I love you more than I've ever loved anyone. Please, will you do me the honour of becoming my wife?
Your heart may be broken tonight. Yeah, it's all right there. But tomorrow in the morning
light, don't let the sun catch you crying. The nighttime shadows
very pleased. Thanks for having me.
Disappear.
Oh, you have it, haven't I? Yes, of course. I do appreciate it.
And with them go all your tears.
Yes,
all the morning,
yes, please,
will bring joy for every girl and boy. So don't let the sun catch you crying.
You'll find this pretty good fit. And for a finishing touch, Dr. Weatherall.
We know the crying.
I'd like to see the lovely dress you have in the window.
Is it? That's the one.
I hope your visit here has been as instructive for you as it has been for us, Mr. Harper.
Oh, yes. It's been a real eye-opener for me, Matron.
Has it?
An apt demonstration, Matron. According to the schedule given to me by your good self, staff nurse Taylor should be at home, not hanging around drinking tea. Dr. Weatherall should be preparing for evening surgery, and yet there she is, all boots and saddles, and only 5:25.
Are you off home, Dr. Weatherall?
Oh, me? No, I'm off to Southwick to change old Mrs. Lacey's dressings, but I'm really quick. I should be back by 6:30 for the end of evening surgery. So lovely to meet you. See you later.
And has something delayed you, staff nurse?
No, matron. Oh, Jenny's got the flu. I'm covering a night shift for her.
And presumably staying on for your own shift tomorrow?
Yeah, of course. Why?
Oh, just checking. Mr. Harper here thought you might be hanging around.
Miss Taylor, Miss Chambers is calling for you.
Excuse me. Shall we be back to perform again?
Ah, yes, Miss Chambers. Perhaps we could see her.
Oh, yes, of course.
An interesting case, Mr. Harper. Miss Chambers presented with traumatic injury to the head following a motorcycle accident. We noted post-auricular ecchymosis, and during her neurological assessment, we also noted hemiparesis. Oh. Projectile vomiting. It's a common complication in head injuries. I'd have thought you'd have known that from your little book, Mr. Harper.
Flaming quid. Is that all we've managed to scrape together?
I did my best, Claude. It wasn't easy.
Yeah, I don't suppose you're used to dealing with live people, are you? You couldn't have tried very hard, could you?
I did. It's just that most folk have put bets on with you before. And being fair, it's hardly the sort of thing you do twice, isn't it?
Yeah, well, make sure you don't lose it. I suppose it's still a nice touch if we get 33s.
Don't forget to take the first show, all right? Because Carol's let her having a fortune on it.
Claude, I'm still not happy about this. I'm a respectable businessman in a very sensitive profession. I can't be seen hanging around betting shops in Ashford Lee.
Well, don't put it on in a betting shop in Ashford Lee. Put it on a betting shop here. And use my name if you have to. Do what you like, but just get the money on, all right?
Bad, love. Made almost 10 quid so far.
Hey, guess what, Kev? It's starting to rain.
It's not, is it?
So, we gonna put a bet on with Mr. Greengrass or what?
Over my dead body. No, we'll give him the satisfaction. We'll see young Rob at the bookies and we'll do it properly.
Well, if it's that good a tip, why not put the raffle money on Yellow Peril? Make even more toward the immediate care fund.
Yeah.
Lizzie! Fran Wheeler's aunt, have your phone number for her?
Yeah, why?
That stupid woman at the dress shop. She sold the dress I'd arranged to hire her for tomorrow.
Oh, no.
I'll have to ring the aunt and see if she has something pretty she can bring in from home. Can't believe
it. You really love me too.
Yeah, got that. OK, then. Bye-bye. Hello, Uncle Ken. You're up and about early.
Yeah. I want to put 10 quid on Yellow Peril in the 1:30 at York this afternoon.
Yeah, you and the rest of the world. That's the third bet I've taken on her in as many minutes.
You what?
It was that rain last night. Everyone seems to know Yellow Peril's better than White Lightning on the soft. She started the week at 6-1. I'm only offering 3-1 now.
I'd have been better off sticking with Greengrass.
What race is he running in?
Oh, it's fine, Aunt Mary.
Why not see if this fits?
Jibby.
Oh, wow! Looks like it's never been worn. How old is it?
It's from Paris Haute Couture. Who cares?
What's Nathan doing with a wedding dress from Paris? I mean, would any wedding dress come to that?
That's a question I feel it's wiser not to ask.
Can I have a little bit of a flutter on the 1:30 at York?
You want Yellow Peril, it's only 5-4.
Oh. Then I think I'll have my £10 on somewhat else. What about blue skies?
Glad you came in. I love an optimist. You can have 40-1, Mr...
Greengrass.
Greengrass? Best of luck, sir.
Good afternoon, St. Aidan's. Oh, hello, Rob. No, you can't, I'm afraid. Dad's busy at the moment.
The look of love is in your eyes. The look your heart can't disguise.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered here together in the sight of God and in the face of this company, to join together this man and this woman in holy matrimony, which is an honorable estate instituted of God and signifying the mystical union that is between Christ and his church. It is commanded of St. Paul to be honorable among all men, and therefore is not to be entered into unadvisedly, but reverently, discreetly, advisedly, soberly, and in the fear of God. If any man can show just cause why this man and this woman may not be joined together, let him now speak, or hereafter, forever, hold his peace. Who gives this woman to marry this man?
I do.
Do you have a ring? Stephen John, do you take this woman, Francesca Mary, to be your lawful wedded wife, in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep you unto her for as long as you both shall live?
I do.
How'd you get 40 to 1?
They didn't think we got a chance.
Good. Yeah, keep it safe. They're all in.
Which one's ours?
The one in green with red, white and blue stripes.
And the outfit.
I now pronounce you man and wife. You may kiss the bride.
Mr. and Mrs. Fairbank, may I be the first to congratulate you.
Blue skies from white lightning and hurricane merging with yellow peril finishing very well and very fast and very late inside the final furlong.
Blue skies
the lead clear from white lightning and yellow peril. Blue skies closing. Blue skies the winner. Yellow peril second, then white lightning and hurricane 30.
Well, where did that come from? Blue skies, that's the one that Johnny Carroll were riding. Thank you very much, Johnny. Rock and
Royal and Alan?
Sorry to interrupt, Mr. Middleditch, but there's an urgent phone call for you.
Right, well, thank you, Lizzie. You do the honours, will you?
Congratulations. Oh, by the way, Rob phoned from the betting shop. Can you give him a ring when you've a moment?
Oh, yeah, right, thanks, love. Alan, you...
Oh, not at all.
Well, no, it's not at all right, actually, but I don't appear to have any say in the matter. Good day.
How guilty do I have to feel?
Guilty?
For being unpleasant to their time and motion man.
Oh, not at all, Matron, not at all. The report was just an excuse. It would have happened with or without him.
Are they really going to close us down?
All services and equipment will be transferred to Ashfordley General.
And the personnel?
My grandfather will be turning in his grave.
Blue skies, not yellow peril. Lizzie, I've lost all the money from the raffle.
He did what?
What he couldn't have done, he's been tucked up here all the time. Hang about. What did he look like? A crafty old... Thinks he's pulling a fast one on me. Now listen, Rob. We need to get the betting slip. And here's what I want you to do.
Thank you, Mr...
Scripps.
Pardon?
Bernie Scripps.
But this belongs to someone called Greengrass.
Yes.
Well, are you Mr. Scripps or are you Mr. Greengrass?
Not sure.
I'm sorry, Mr. whoever you are, but I can't pay out on this ticket. They've announced an inquiry. You'll have to come back tomorrow.
Lord isn't going to like this.
Here, £410 less tax. That's exactly £400, and you owe me fivepence. Hey, you can keep that instead of me giving you a birthday present this year.
This never happened, okay?
I just wanted to say thank you for everything.
It's our pleasure.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Excuse me, before you all leave, would this be a good time to draw the raffle? For your immediate care fund?
Oh, yes, that. Well, I don't see why not, do you? Did you manage to sell many tickets?
A few, Dr. Romerod. A few.
I think a quick
quiet word individually rather than a mass announcement, don't you?
If we're given the choice.
Hello, what's this?
Ken's been raising money for the immediate care fund and he'd like to give us the proceeds from his raffle.
How very kind.
And the winner is... number 26, Mr. Claude Greengrass. Well, as of this morning, the proceeds from the raffle stood at £7.10.6. However, thanks to Mr. Greengrass's expert advice, we placed the money on a horse in this afternoon's race, and Blue Skies duly came in at 40-1. So, it gives me great pleasure, Dr. Ormerod, to present you with £407.10.6 for your immediate care fund. Thanks to Mr. Greengrass and his winning tip from Mr. Johnny Carroll.
It's incredible.
Yes, it is. There you go, Claude. It's your lucky day. There's your consolation prize.
Do I detect a modicum of chicanery regarding my winnings?
Not a modicum, Claude. A dirty great dollop. And it's your own fault for not letting me in on it.
Yeah, I'll try and remember next time.
Oh, there won't be a next time. You're being discharged tomorrow.
Hope you realise we're homeless.
Maybe Harper was right.
What?
Raffles and racing tips. Hardly a reliable way to run a hospital, is it? Maybe we do deserve to close.
My name's Dr. Cheris. And yours is?
Oh, no, you don't.
No smoking on my ward.
Paint. There must be enough here to paint the fourth bridge.